Fear is like fire. If not controlled, it could burn down everything around you. But if used properly, it can fuel you to reach your highest potential.
My mentor, Custer Bottle, told me the only thing that separates the hero from being a coward is what the hero does that makes him the hero, and what the coward doesn't do that makes him the coward. They both have fear, but with this fear, something is ignited in the hero. When fear challenges you, what will you do? Introducing Tyson Pro.
Yeah, Tyson. Yeah, I'm Mike Tyson.
Yeah. Tyson, we about to break you down.
Yeah, it's ludicrous.
This is another episode of Hot Boxing. I'm Mike Tyson.
I'm who?
The guest is Hoye Marvadol. Right?
Close enough. Close.
All right, y'all know who the If you're watching the show, you know he's going to be on the show. You know who the motherfucker is, okay? So what's up, brother?
What's up, man?
Oh, beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
I thought you were excited, man. The big fight coming up. September
8th. Tell us about that.
Yeah.
Let's just jump into this shit.
I got Fabricio Werdum, which is a UFC ex-heavyweight champion.
I know him.
Yeah.
He's listen, California, yeah. My trainer great trains training, him. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Great trainer. He's making a comeback, but bare knuckling. He's going to be fighting Junior Dos Santos. Which
I know Junior. Junior's champ, too.
Exactly, both of them. They're going to be fighting bare knuckle, no gloves, September 8th.
You got a good match. Who matched that up?
Me and my matchmaker.
Yeah, Dream that's tool. A good match. Yeah. Perfect.
Fabricio.
I got to go with him, you know. We got the same
you
got to
come here to fight, Mike. It'd be an honor to have you there, man.
If you can when the next
out,
one?
September 8th, Jacksonville.
Yeah, okay. We come to check that shit out. Jacksonville, all those Florida fucking psychopaths. Florida is some shit, nigga. Yo. It's like a country within a country. You know that, right? It's
Florida,
a jungle.
Different than the whole
Florida's
country.
A jungle, man. Ain't no new shit. Yeah. We're in Florida. If you go any further, nigga, you're gonna be out through those alligators and shit. Yeah.
I thought it'd be cleared in Vegas first. It got cleared in Florida. It's always Florida.
I think Vegas, New York, those places probably be like the last ones.
Really?
The ones. Yeah.
They worry about what people think about them and stuff because they have a bad reputation. Look, Vegas, New York, bad reputation. So they want to clean up the reputation. We don't do this. Have that savage sport here. It was the same thing with UFC.
When it first came out, that's what I'm saying, Mike. Like, can you imagine, like, when UFC first came out, how everybody was against it, the banning and everything. I can imagine what you're going through.
But listen,
like, yours is more ruthless, right?
It's big in Europe, though, stuff like that.
Yeah, it's getting, like, the bare knuckle boxing.
Yeah, underground, bare knuckle fighting is big in England.
You been in them before, Mike?
Huh?
Like
no, but I met the champions of the bare knuckle fighters, underground champions. Yeah.
In Europe?
Yeah. Holy they're gosh. Celebrities, too.
Do they televise those?
I think probably people might film them.
Okay.
I've seen them film. You can have film. You film them.
Yeah, I've been to those in Miami since I was like young. I would like to go to one in England and stuff, see how they do
it's
it.
It's this guy named McLean. I don't know, Danny McLean. And for me, he's just a bruiser, man. A bruiser.
You got to be a certain individual to be like in bare knuckles, huh? Can you explain where this came from?
Well, I got the invite to fight with in Kimbo's backyard. And it was bare knuckle.
I
remember
I was just watching that too. You're a heavy set guy, black ball head guy. You're a fight. Yeah. He's bigger than you though.
Yeah, yeah. He's a little bigger than me. And that was like my first also like exposure to the world. I remember the video dropping. It was like, this is over 20 years ago. And the video had like 50,000 views. And then like 3 weeks later had like 300,000 views. And this was in YouTube back then. So it gave me a huge, huge exposure. So I always said, I want to give these fighters as much exposure as possible. And something that I started with as well and that I still love. And those fans always stayed with me throughout the journey because they're seeing you fight bare knuckle. So I said, why not make it as close as I can to a real fight? You know, because another thing, not just for the hitting, but when you're choking and you have tape gauze and then you have the glove that's like 2 inches, there's certain spots you can't get in because of the glove.
Oh, wow.
So you'll get to like a good position and it kind of becomes a stalemate because, you know, you could just grab this glove and now they can't. But when it's just a hand, it's so much more slippery, especially with sweat. So now when they get into these good positions where usually you might be able to finish a guy and you can't because you could stall an MMA with the gloves, now we're seeing that you can't stall. So more submissions, more finishes, and it's just better for the fans, man. More people are getting hurt quicker.
I mean, the rules are the same.
Basically. The rules are exactly the same. Five-minute rounds, 1 minute break. Yeah, all we did is take out the gloves. All the rules are the same. You can't knee a downed opponent. You can't, you know, eye poke. You can't do any of that crazy stuff. It's just bare knuckle, but MMA.
Would you do that, Mike? Would you do bare knuckle?
Consider it. If they paid me, I'd do anything if they paid me. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Isn't that, like, more ruthless? Like, you know, like the bare knuckleness, like, well, what's your idea of that?
I don't know. It's the hurt business. You know, we're all in the hurt business, and that's just what it is. It's just a different form of hurt game.
But that's like guaranteed blood right there.
Nothing's guaranteed. Somebody might get knocked out in 8 seconds or something. Nothing's guaranteed.
Yeah. When I went to the first fight, man, it was crazy. The heavyweights, everybody waited for the end. Like, heavyweights were bare knuckle in his first.
Oh, God, them big. They want to see big. That's what they like. They like these big brutes. Bust your brains out. Some guys can kill you. They punch so hard. They don't look like nobody. They're simply fucking whackers.
And how many rounds does it usually go to? Like, is it usually the same?
Five, man.
Five rounds, but so the last show we had 12 fights and it was 9 finishes. So it's a lot of action. Even when it's been boring for a little bit, both guys are maybe a little hesitant. Once they start grappling, like I said, the chance for submission is better without the gloves. That's why a lot of grapplers like it. A lot of strikers like it, obviously, because you could just cut somebody's face usually easier. But it goes both ways. You could also break your hand, you know?
Oh, wow.
So you got tape and gauze, but still, there's a slight more risk. You have more impact to the hand than it maybe. You
know. Darren, like 200 years ago when they had, no, probably more, 300 years ago when they had the bare knuckle fighters, they always broke their hand. That's why the rounds last so long. Every time they got knocked down, it was the end of a round.
I just realized it's not easy to knock somebody out bare knuckle, too.
That don't want to be knocked out. Yeah. You know, it's hard to beat somebody that don't want to quit.
Yeah. Mm. And that is experienced and has been doing it, putting in the time, and yeah, it's problematic.
The crazy white boy always wins. You always bet on the crazy white boy in those fights?
I bet on who's in the best shape, who's the meanest looking, you know, and a lot of these guys, like in the JDS and Verdum, though, JDS Junior Dos Santos has been my teammate for like 7-8 years. I'm very in this fight. Like, I don't know who to pick. Obviously, I want the best outcome. But, man, this is a tough one for me, man.
Evenly matched.
Verdum on the ground is a world vicious champion. He's, I think, maybe 2 or 3-time world champion.
I remember he beat Fedor.
He beat Fedor.
Yeah, Fedor was the top thing in the world. Yeah. Everybody around the world also heard that. In
Strikeforce, he beat him. He triangled him.
Leg,
almost
right.
Snapped his arm off as well.
He's a great wrestler.
Yeah.
Great wrestler.
Great jiu-jitsu. Once it hits the ground, it's game over. But JDS is very good at stopping takedowns. So they're going to stay on their feet, I think, for a good majority of the fight. And, I mean, both on the feet are great, you know. Fabricio has a lot of different attacks. Kick, punch, knee, elbow. He does it all well on the feet. But Junior has crazy power, man, you know. Crazy explosion. He still has great speed.
That's a perfect match, though.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
The one fight I saw, the Ray Nelson fight, man. Like, he's a beast, man. That's what I'm talking about. Like,
He doesn't look it. You know, he doesn't look like your typical fighter.
White boy in these kind of fights, man.
And then, boom, you know.
Matt Hughes was great. He was a white kid. He was great, remember him?
Matt Hughes was an animal. You should love him. Watch him take people down, just beat the crap out of him.
Calm, norm. Now, don't break. Don't jump around. Just kick his ass. Yeah. Don't worry about it.
What?
You just take
little
guys
white
down.
Boy and shit.
Yeah. He'd take guys down and elbow their fucking teeth.
I saw him fight Gracie. Listen, he had Gracie on the floor. His face was face down. He was bending his arm. He had his arm bent around his back. He wouldn't tap out. So he had to beat him unconscious. Yeah. He wouldn't tap out. He had to bend all. I said, hard. I thought it was coming off.
You witnessed all that shit?
Yeah,
that shit
he wouldn't give in.
Man, he's just a beast, man.
Yeah, he wasn't giving.
He had like 50 or something pro fights, you know.
Who's that?
Matt Hughes. He had a bunch of fights. He had a ton of fights. One of the greatest welterweights in the sport.
Absolutely. You know, he had unfortunately had a bad accident. What a fighter, huh? What a fighter.
I see a lot of MMA fighters that come in to check it out just to peep it. I saw Kay Usman was over there. Like a lot of the elites was like, seeing
the bare knuckle stuff.
What's this about? Like,
yeah.
What are their reactions? What are they telling you?
They love it. Not all of them. I've had a lot of hand injuries, so me myself, I couldn't do it right now. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them say, "Man, I would do this, but I got hand injuries." But no matter what, they love the product that they're seeing in front of them because the fights are just faster paced. It just sounds different.
Yeah, but bone you on, hear the punches,
you
know, like,
it sounds just a little different, you know. So everybody's loving it, man. I'm getting a good feedback.
Are you retired? Are you really retired? Or what's up, man?
No,
yeah. People are questioning. No,
from. So when I signed up the MMA, I wanted to fight the best in the world and make the most money possible. I feel like I've reached a point where I can't fight the best in the world, like the top five guys, because my reflexes have slowed down just a tad bit. But I'm seeing certain people box. I don't want to say names and stuff. And I'm like, these guys are not boxers, man. You know, I would be open.
What do you think about Jake Paul?
I personally, I like his story because I got to meet him a couple times, and so on the personal, I like him a lot, but like as a boxer and stuff, I wouldn't say he's a boxer yet. You know, he had a perfect chance to display, you know, boxing against Nate, and he's still not there, you know, in certain levels, but I like that he changed his life around for boxing, you know. Yeah. He told me how he was living his life before that. It was pretty reckless, and in combat brought structure, much like it did to my life as well. So on that note, I take my hat off to him. But if actually like boxing and stuff, nah, he's got.
He would fuck it. I mean, Nate Diaz, he went against Nate. Nate is a free agent now. Would you bring him
ever
over?
Ever ask Jay somebody?
Nah, somebody I don't think I'd bring Nate over to promotion, but I'd box him or something, you know, because he's always wanted a rematch. I would, you know, I'd be open to do some boxing because this is my first love ever was boxing. That I discovered, and then MMA came like 4 or 5 years later.
So you lived in Cuba though, right?
No, I lived here. Miami. Oh, okay. My dad.
I've been in Cuba a couple of times.
Yeah? For tournaments?
He's hanging out.
Or just hanging. Did you ever compete over there?
No. Yeah. It was this great fighter named Teofilo Stevenson. So yeah. I went to his house. I wanted to meet him. I went to his house.
Yeah. He's one of the greats of all time.
Oh, what a man.
An amateur. 3-time gold medalist?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We are 4.
Yeah. Yeah, the meanest jab, the meanest
yes,
right
yes,
now.
Yes.
He looks so like simple and basic.
You know, his father was Jamaican though.
Yeah.
Mother's Cuban, that's what the rumor was. I can't believe it. They're real close because I came from Jamaica to come to Cuba. That's the people that go to Jamaica to come to Cuba.
Then Felix Yeron came after him.
Yeah, the other heavyweight, yeah, Felix.
Now, Cuba has a long lineage of amateur animals.
Yeah, who's the first one that came out? The Kid Chocolate, huh? You ever hear of him?
Yeah.
Kid Chocolate, the first Cuban world champion. Yeah. He made money too. Nobody made money like him. He made 50,000 in some fight. Nobody made heavyweight champion. Wow. They didn't make no money like that. In the early, late 20s, early 30s. No, he was making that kind of money.
Oh, he was making 50,000 back then.
Well, that's like in two fights. Yeah. He would make 15, 30 in a fight. He's just. Back then, no one made money like that. So that's how Henry Armstrong, who was another great fighter, he was working on the railroad and he saw a Kid Chocolate make that money. He said he quit fucking working. So that little 125-pound guy from Cuba could do it. So I can do it too. He just quit working after he saw that in the paper.
Kid Gavilan to another Cuban fighter.
I met him too. I met Mr. Gavilan.
I wish I would have met him. I tried to meet him many times, man.
Mr. Gavilan. He was an older man when I met, but he still was conscious. To ask him about the fight with Robinson. He was just a great fighter. Ike, well, he fought them all. He wasn't afraid of nobody.
Fucking old, yeah.
Geraldo Gonzalez is his name. That's his name. You know I'm a fucking freak. I know all these guys. I know their mother's name. Yeah.
Did you fight for free in the beginning, or how much did you get paid in the beginning?
No. Once I went pro, I always got I got paid. But when I was young and my friends knew I could fight, it was just like they placed bets on me against somebody else that they knew could fight. And that's it, like that, you know.
What?
Yeah. So that's how I came around to get into Kimbo's backyard. I had a reputation for that, and then we ended up at the same gym, coincidentally, and then they invited me. He was like, hey, you want to come fight for us? And I was like, fucking
bitch. You know, like I wanted to say in England, right, when they have a championship fight, I think it's on the – listen – it's like a black tie event in England. If you ever see that, it's just everybody's out there, the end people, everybody's out there.
Oh, like an underground, like
yeah, it's packed.
I want to go to one in England. Whoever's running these in England, please reach out.
Yeah, for real. Yeah. It's really popular over there. People are real. And listen, those countries like London, all those cities, I mean, everybody's tough. Everybody grew up fighting. They fought the Romans. You know?
That's like invite only, right? Like, it's like,
no, I guess you get paid. I don't know if it's legal or not, but I looked at some of those arenas. It's packed like a normal fight.
I got to go check one of these out.
They have to be legal. They're illegal. They have to be. Hey, let's...
It has to be legal.
It has to be.
There's too many heads.
Posters are up. That's why.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's definitely legal. Where do you see the most violent show on earth?
Oh,
I'm
gonna look for it.
Yeah.
As of right now, we're streaming it on all my platforms, my Twitter, my YouTube.
Bare knuckle fighting legal in England.
I think so.
Yes, it is legal.
Oh, it's legal.
I know I'm not losing my fucking mind. They have a black tie event. Black tie event watching this shit. I was fucked up too when I saw that. This is top class.
Like blood everywhere.
Yeah. Politicians, everybody.
Wow.
Royal family niggas, everybody, man. It's big over there.
So where do you see your company in the next couple of years from now?
Just putting on consistent good shows, giving guys a way, another big avenue to make money and represent and get their shine on. You know, Dana White used to give this speech. He used to give a nice speech before we compete. And he'd always refer to Stephon Bonner versus Forrest Griffin and how they blew the sport up. And
they went bare knuckle?
No. This was an alternate
fight. I know
they
were, but they didn't. I thought they were.
No, bare knuckle. And he would say how they fought. And in 15 minutes... they changed their lives forever, you know? So I remember I took that speech to heart always, and I would always try to go out there and do that. And then in 5 seconds, I was able to change my life forever, you know? So now it's like the same thing for these guys. Go out there and get your dreams accomplished, you know? We're paying well. We're giving these guys a lot of exposure as much as we can. So I have a good mixture of guys that already did it, guys.
It's going to be easy for you to get some, because you can always get some ex-boxers that are still shape that could fight people.
Yeah. The thing about the boxers though, a lot of them don't like the wrestling part. So that's the only problem I have recruiting them. But if it was like a boxer versus like a kickboxer, things like that, then it gets real interesting.
And they should do it. They've been doing that for years. Yeah, man.
And I love those type of fights. I used to watch them. I think what's a tall dude with the dreads. My CTE just
talking about early UFC when this
boxer. Okay. He fought in kickboxing. He fought Lennox Lewis and lost to him. What's his name?
Who?
With the dreads. Let's go, champ. I can't.
Shannon Biggs.
Yeah, here we go.
Oh, this motherfucker,
Shannon Briggs,
man.
My CTE kicked in, man.
He fucks with everybody, man.
Right. But he fought in kickboxing. He fought a kickboxer in Japan. I remember watching this. Like, I don't know.
Did the guy fuck him up?
I don't remember. No. We gotta look it up.
Hey, Shannon Briggs, heavyweight boxer fights.
Kickboxing. I don't remember the guy. Yeah. He fought I'm almost sure it was him that fought kickboxing.
Shannon Briggs. Sorry, thank you. Shannon Briggs.
I think he was losing and won or so. I don't remember exactly what.
Wow. Look it up.
You get it? Look, who's he fighting? Look and see, that's the top one, huh? He's fighting the UFC guy? He is so crazy. We got him, we put him on hot boxing too before.
Oh, yeah, you
have him. Who's he fighting, though? Oh, every time he got knocked out.
No. Be against a kickboxer.
Against the kickboxer.
In a cross match.
This guy is so crazy. Yeah, that's the guy.
That's a wild matchup.
Yeah, look at this guy. He got the gloves on too.
Wild matchups. Oh,
Shannon's so crazy. By any chance, can you allow it to be larger?
Is that Kimbo Slice?
That's Shannon.
Oh, okay. I was about to say.
Oh, you really did a good job. Look at this guy. This guy looks crazy.
Leg kicks made me scream. Yeah, if you've never been hit with a leg kick, it's different.
You can't get in shape for that either. Shannon, get close to him. That kick. You gonna break him down. Oh. That's it.
See ya.
That's what he was looking for.
Yeah, I think he got him with that in the second round. The first round, he was getting chopped up, and then the second round, boom, took him out.
Oh, I know. He said, oh, shit. When he kicked me, he said, oh, shit.
Yeah.
All right.
What are the differences in pain when you get kicked in, like, stomach and leg? What was it like?
The body's maybe that's the worst thing, bro. The leg too, because maybe that leg will go, you know, it's like, it feels like a Charlie horse and I can't quite move it. It's not responding.
So why is it legs don't break? I've been thinking, your leg, they get to kick each other.
Yeah. I've seen legs break. I see somebody in UFC try to kick somebody, the guy put his knee up, boom, breaks. Yeah. Right in half.
Yeah.
The skin is holding it up. The bone is completely broke.
Yeah. And sometimes the bone will poke through the skin.
Sharp piece of bone.
Yeah. It's had Anderson Silva, to one of the greatest of all time. It happened. He broke his leg. And it's
crazy. That fight.
Yeah.
It was against the guy from Long Island. What was his name again?
Chris Weidman.
Yeah.
Which, weirdly enough, he broke his leg his last fight out, so now he's recovered from it. He's making a comeback. That's crazy. It's one of those like freak accidents, but it happens, you know. Some guys don't, but when I was competing a lot, I would condition my legs a lot by not just kicking the back, but if I was just hanging around, I'd get like a piece of stick or just a piece of metal and just touch it, not hard, but I'm just constantly touching it just to like build callus, and like at 10-20%, really? Yeah, and that just also kills the nerves. It's something you want to build like small calluses on and have it conditioned, so when you whack somebody, because it hurts, man. I mean, even if I kick, like if I kick Mike in the elbow, you're going to get a welt, you know, so you got to have it condition to be able to fucking.
That's how come I can never fight those mixed martial arts or MMA, because if somebody step on my feet, I'm gonna just tap out.
Oh, really? It's over.
No. It's a wrap. My feet, my toes look like they blew up, and he's gonna step on them, boom!
Nah.
I could not. I'm tapping out.
So all that shit I see in the movies, like in Kickboxer, when Van Damme's opponent was like kicking the
tree,
kicking the pole. Is that real? He was like,
not a concrete pole.
Do that.
Yeah, that'll hurt.
Thailand.
Yeah, in Thailand they'll kick the banana trees. They'll wreck those things. They'll chop them down. Like it's their job.
Yeah.
So like you've done full research on all this shit before you even like. Got heavy in it, like
in the fight. Yeah. Since I discovered boxing since 7-8, and that was I didn't care about nothing else. And then around like 11-12 years old, I discovered MMA, and I was like, that's it. You know, I didn't ever see like a whole soccer game, basketball game, football game. I didn't have the attention span for that, and I was incredibly hyper. Numerous things just pointed me to combat, so I didn't ever. Care about anything else. I was the biggest fucking nerd you ever seen, like for boxing or MMA. You know, I knew everybody, every champion, all that stuff. So that's all I did. By the time I turned pro at 18, I had a good wealth of knowledge of where I should be investing my time in and what I should be doing to get to the next level. Like looking up to guys like Matt Hughes and all these guys, what they were doing and stuff. You know,
that's the way to do it.
How was the struggling part of it? Like, you know, what was that like? Like, what did you struggle with?
Money.
Huh? Yeah, money, definitely. There's no fighting. There was no money in MMA when I started 20-something years ago, especially for the beginning guys, you know. You want to fight, maybe you got $400 or $500, and that's not really enough. So you just got to hustle, man, you know, teaching private lessons or whatever the fuck. But no matter how bad the situation got, I always knew just like fighting, it's going to get better. I'm going to get out of here. You know, this is just my moment for the moment right now. Eventually I'm gonna get out of this and I'm gonna be onto much better things.
So you probably got the fastest knockout in the UFC, huh?
Yes, sir. Yes,
that was
sir.
A good one.
Nobody's beating that, huh? Shit, 5 seconds.
That's a hell of a record, 5 seconds.
Yeah. You know, I had had done my work on the dude, and I knew he was a crotch sniffer, but he was gonna sniff the crotch as soon as I invaded his space. That's what he does. He just ducks.
Ben Askren, right?
Ben Askren, you know, so went for it, you know.
How do you feel after that? Like, you do some crazy shit like that. Is there a different way of screaming or like?
It felt good, you know, because I had seen it in my head many, many times. Mm. And I knew that even if I didn't hit him in the chin, if I hit him anywhere, even in the shoulder, he'd be wrecked, you know? So I had game planned this in my head so many times that when I saw it happen, I wasn't even...
Derek Lewis, who kind of like did a quick knockout the other day. What do you think about
that? Oh, he was
that good. It wasn't as clean as you, but it was kind of quick.
I was sitting there cage side. I was like, wow.
Oh, you were there.
I was at a fight where he just lost against the big Russian guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Ukrainian guy. Russian.
He trains big out of American Top Team. Yes. Yep. Shout out to American Top Team. How's just all these killers.
American Top Team in the house.
Have you been?
Never. It's showing you. Love. It's showing love.
It'd be
love.
An honor, man, if we could take you over there, bro.
God willing.
Yes.
That's crazy, man. I always wonder what would go through your head after you seen that Derek Lewis shit, man. Like,
I was right there sitting, and when they hit the floor, it was like 3 seconds in. So I was like, help, he's going to break it. And then time passed, and I was like, oh, he's not
going to break it. Because
mine, I took off to the side, and I walked, so there was a little bit of time gap before I like dropped him. He ran right at him and threw it. So within like 2-3 seconds, Buddy was down. And I was like, snap, there goes my record, dog.
I didn't know heavyweights even go that route, like, to even
Derek,
do it.
Derek is explosive. He doesn't look it, crazy. But man, that guy can move, man. He's a fucking cat.
Heavyweight doing a flying kick, man. That's just fucking
Bruce Lee shit, huh?
Opening up with it, you know, within seconds just went right into it. And what his manager, his coaches, everybody told me that he just thought about that last minute. It wasn't even like he was prepping for it. That's what makes it even scarier. Like, he just decided to throw it, you know?
So the probabilities are, like, endless in that world of fighting, man. It's all about, like, trying to...
No, tell me what it's about.
Like, you're very opportunist. Like, you have to take the opportunity.
Definitely.
It's never a plan. Like,
definitely. You know, and then sometimes you take that opportunity, think it's an opportunity, but somebody laid out a trap for you, and they just murder your ass. They just catch you, you know. So then you get hesitant, like, hey, should I take this or not? You know, that's the amazing thing about fighting. It's always been my favorite sport. It's a human chess match. So many things go into it if you're in shape, because maybe you might be 10 times the athlete that I am and even better. But if you run out of gas, if that Ferrari runs out of gas, the Honda Civic is going to beat it, man. So if you get tired in, then that's a very real thing. I'm going to jump all over you and forget about game plans and fucking, you might even be better athlete than me. But at that moment, you're done, you know? So being in shape is like a huge factor.
Gotta be in shape and fight.
Mike, is that kind of like the same with boxing? Like, I know there's a plan when you go in with your opponent.
Gotta be in shape and boxing.
And people be saying this guy's gonna beat Ali. When you fight Ali, be fucking prepared to go 15, nigga.
15. He's going all the way.
And at any moment, he's pulling the trigger.
Woo!
It ain't that easy, right?
Oh, you start, nigga, you're full of exhaustion. Yeah, he can't wait this shit over. 15 rounds, nigga.
And talking to you the whole time.
Yeah, talking shit, talking about your mother.
they yapping? Do y'all do that?
Yeah.
Do you talk to whoever, like, secretly?
There's a couple people, because this is a grappling position where it's easier to talk.
Talking in here.
I always talk to people.
Fucking die.
That's part of fighting. Gotta talk shit.
You gotta talk. Getting their head a little extra, you know?
Yeah.
But I'll leave with something else at it, man.
Who gave you the most issues, like, out of all the, in your career? You remember gave you the most issues? After defeating him, of course.
I would say, you know, I always fared well against strikers because that was my forte. That's what I was blessed with the striking speed and having, like, a good sense of distance and radar. Grappling is always what I put so much time into it, extra than I did on my striking, just to be, like, just to catch up to the grapplers and just to be able to fend off their attacks, because I didn't want to grapple necessarily, but I wouldn't be worth anything in MMA if I can't keep it on my feet, right? So I got to be able to wrestle defensively very good. So guys that would primarily not want to fight but just, like, fucking sniff your crotch, those guys would give me trouble because it's not, you know, it's not like a fight. You know, they're just, like, wrestling and they're getting to positions where you're stalling, you know. They're not really advancing or trying to throw blows. They're just, like, holding on to you and trying to eat the clock up. And some guys are very good at that. I wasn't the best at defending those, so those would
but
be
my toughest.
But
that's what you have to do. That's what fighting is about, deciphering styles and overcoming them.
Yep.
That must get annoying as fuck, huh?
So, yeah, those would be the ones that would be more troublesome for me.
See, now, that's when I like UFC, when they're on the ground. Mm. It's not boring to me. I'm watching people move, setting up openings and shit. That's what I like.
When you got, like, a Khabib in front of you or like, a Matt Hughes or George St. Pierre, these guys are, like, passing and they're hitting and they're trying to advance position. But there's guys that'll just take you down and just, like, squeeze your waist and... They're not doing anything. They're just staying in this one position. They're putting all their energy.
Gracie shit.
Yeah. The Gracies are going for the finish. They're trying to choke you the fuck out, you know, so that's different. I don't like the guys that are eating up clocks.
With the gear.
Hey, Mike, I got a question. I know you used to train. I've seen a lot of things. Like, you wake up at 4:30 in the morning. Mm-hmm. You start doing your workout. Then later in your career, did you switch those times up? Or when you got in camp, it was always the same?
Always the same.
Always the same. Yeah. And why do you think that helped you out so much, like getting up early at that time? Just because you knew you were putting in extra than nobody else is awake at?
No. First of all, that's what I like. I wanted all the fighting. I wanted the rest, the running. I wanted the boxing, the sparring. And plus, psychologically, if I get up at 3 or 4 in the morning, you know, my opponent's not up at 3 and 4 in the morning. So that's my psychological advantage.
Oh, wow.
How many hours would be, like, your first session of the day?
After 4 o'clock, I come back home. I do some exercises. Then I may take a hot bath, and I'll go back to sleep. Maybe eating breakfast as well. I get up. I'll go to the gym at 12 o'clock. Go to the gym, box 10 rounds maybe. But worked up to 10 rounds, the box 10 rounds maybe. And then do the row work at the bag, body exercise, abs and everything.
That is crazy.
Then go home. But it doesn't finish till after night because at 7 o'clock, I got to go to the weight gym.
Again?
Yeah, it's an all-day process.
This is every day?
Yeah.
How many hours is the first session?
Huh? The first session is
How long would you say it was?
Me just doing that run. 4 or 5 miles.
What would you do your miles in them? So, what would you do, like, a mile in back then?
In time?
Yeah.
And I did, like, what? Probably 8 minutes.
Nice, man. And what's the max you'd run? 5-6 miles?
Yeah.
Would it best up your shins a lot? You had a lot of pain in your knees? Were your knees good always?
Always, yeah. Always. Just sometimes my hips. As I get older, I get sciatica. Mm. But running is the best exercise. You gotta do some exercise for your mind. Running is the best. That's mind exercise.
Would you always run or would you do sprints as well? Switch it up.
I do sprints well. Yeah.
How close to the fight? Like 3 weeks? That's when you start doing sprints for?
Listen, I train up to the fight.
No, I know, but I would always switch on my running. Like, I would. Let's say I'm 6-7 weeks out for my weight as well. I would run, like, long distance. 4 weeks out, I would always drop the long distance and I'd move it towards sprints. Like, if I got that long distance and I did 4 miles of sprints instead of just 4 miles straight, you know, where I had, like,
I'll do 4 or 5 miles and I won't count it. And then I do my sprints and stuff up there and do my little running up there. You know, I never counted that morning run.
Okay.
Okay, and then after that we go eat lunch, we come back, we fool around in the house, then around we play, you know, me and my friend did, we gamble for push ups. You know, my bank may be 1,000, that's what we do. Everything's about fighting.
Yeah.
Getting your body ready. We gamble for push ups, sit ups.
So like a G stack. We put a
still
G
do
stack
that Tuesday.
Excuse me?
Put like a G stack up.
Well, I'll say my stock is 1,000 push ups. You're gonna do them that day or that night. You're gonna finish them. We're going to finish him. Ain't like tomorrow. Can I do him tomorrow? No, you're going
to
finish him.
Same rules I play by. That's the only way to do it. Play.
And when I train, everybody in my house train. All these niggas that I give a check, they better train with me. Everybody got to train.
Sounds like somebody I know.
Everybody got to fucking train. Listen, this is the real deal, my friend told me. Everybody want to spend the $10 million, but they don't want to run the 10 miles.
Oh, shit.
You know what I mean? They want to spend the $10 million, help, but they don't want to run the 10 motherfucking miles. So everybody's working out. Nigga, you ain't eating. I'm not eating. You ain't eating, motherfucker. You around me, give me money and shit. And you're just going to be a fat motherfucker around me eating while I'm sweating and dying in this motherfucker. My wife get mad at them. I said, fuck them. They going to work out, too. Get my fucking money, living like me, and they think they're just gonna lay back.
Why are you cutting weight?
Yeah,
sweating,
I'm mad as a motherfucker.
Getting punched in the face.
I got a black eye. I'm a little, my head hurts a little. These niggas eating dick sandwiches and partying shit, motherfuckers. I know you know those kind of guys. They want to help spend the fucking money, but not run the miles.
They're gonna order the bottles.
Yeah.
Then when the check comes. They got them T-Rex arms.
Yeah. My wife called them alligator arms.
Yeah, alligator arms. They can't. Yeah, I know them, man.
Well, after hearing his regimen, like, what's the comparison? Do you see his is, like, harder or with yours?
Very similar because we're both, he's putting in 6-7 hours a day, and we're about the same one, putting in 4 to 5 hours a day, you know? Maybe... Where it changes is that, like I mentioned earlier, grappling and wrestling is such a big component in it. So I have to put so much time in there. And then to get that endurance, there's really only one way, is by doing it as well. You know, so the technique and the endurance, you got to get after it. And then we got weightlifting involved as well to get a little bit stronger, to become a better athlete. But the regimen is the same.
They train so much smarter than we did. Everybody that trained in my time all fucked up. They did extra too many. We did too many sessions. We did too many push-ups. We did too many sit-ups. You know what I mean? We did too many sprints.
Was the sparring always hard? Every sparring session was all out?
Listen, if you didn't fuck me up, you're fired. If you don't kick my ass in here, you're fucking fired. That's what it was like.
So
let's go for real. This is real now. Let's go, right? This is not sparring. This is real. My trainer told me, this is real. This is not sparring. Protect yourself at all times.
Oh, shit.
No, ask my right hand guard. Protect yourself at all times, okay? You're not sparring. This is real. This is a fight. Spar like you're fighting. The first thing my trainer tells them. Give me your best. Just because he's a young boy, don't take it easy. Give me your best.
Imagine you're one of the many in the flock, because I've seen the video, one of the four there, and you see like the first two get laid out. You're like, you know, Mike, because my mom is calling, right? And I forgot the dog, and I left the stove. I'll be back, though.
Because they be talking shit in the gym, some of these new spawn points. Knock one of them cold when I tell them.
Next.
I'm right in the garden and come in.
Nah, because my mom don't like when I stay out late, dog. I got a roll, bro.
No, we paying these guys top dollar, $1,000 a round, man.
Oh, shit. Damn.
$1,000 for 3 minutes. For 3 minutes, $1,000.
3 minutes? I'm going to put the skates on you. Fuck.
They extra charge. Sometimes they go 2,000. Listen, we'll pay. We want the best guy. We spar with the contenders, niggas. We're going to eventually have to fight. Want the best. If you don't got the best, you can't fight the best. Somebody's taking you. You okay? All right. No, nigga, take my head off. Yeah.
Amen. That's just how it is.
Who's your sparrer? You have a sparrer you want to shout out that kind of like helped you?
Oh, I got in my career, we spar always wouldn't be a fight. But in like the wrestling, grappling department, you're always going to go as hard as you can go, you know? And then because there's not like when you hit somebody, there's no, I give you a chance to tap before you hit. If I got a submission on tight and we're both pros, we know, I already know when I've been beat out that much that I got to let my ego go and go, oh, you got me, cool. So there's no injury.
Oh,
you know?
What is sparring?
Can't, got to live to fight another day.
Yeah. What?
That's smart fighting.
So that's like in grappling jiu-jitsu, because if every time I get in a compromised position and I'm not, you know, tapping, things could happen, you know, which has happened to me even though I'm quick to, like, I'd rather save it for the fight. If somebody has me deep enough, I'll tap. So in wrestling, you go 100% until that point, and then, you know, you give the guy a chance. Like, hey, I got you. I'm giving you a chance to tap. If they don't...
Yeah, I'm a strong believer. Don't be having no... Listen, the guys that have guts in boxing don't finish well. Tap out and live to fight another day. Yeah. Don't get so all fucked up and brain dead.
Yeah,
then you can't fight no more. You know? Because your ego, now you can't fight.
And it happens.
Fucked up way to end. If you ever had those horrifying endings, like you always see like the future, like I hope this ain't me, or you learn from other experiences from other fighters?
Definitely learn from others, but I always stop when I can't hang with the pack, and I got, just like Mike said, I feel like I'm at the best gym in the world, American Top Team. We have another world champion now at 125. And I feel like I've always gotten the best sparring partner. So I always said, man, once I can't keep it with the pack, or I'm not being as successful as I used to be against these machines, then maybe my time has come. You know, and also in the fighting, I've slowed down just a tad bit on my reflexes enough that I don't feel like how I was when I was like 30. All the way up to like 19 to 35, my reflexes are pretty intact. 36, 37, 38 is when I started seeing like in the gym a small decrease. You know
why that is? Because our mind is on something else more than it is fighting. It's our mind that puts us in that state of mind, no matter what age you are. You know, our mind, because listen, this is the real deal, right? If we keep saying our age is our tamer, then we don't know how old we are. We don't know our fucking age for real. How do we know old? Julius Caesar said 365 days of the year. Before he was born, how do we tell our age? You know? That's the real. We don't know how old we are.
That's real.
Well, yeah, that's just who we are. We're fungus.
I'm not comparing you to Nate, but he got fucked up by Jake. If you and Jake was in the ring, what would you do to this guy?
Hey, look, everybody up around said Nate looked high. You think he looked high? Be honest.
On the fight, I mean, he's always looked the same.
Yeah,
the last 20 years that I've seen him, man.
Oh, really?
Did you fought him?
Yeah.
I must have been so awesome. Yeah,
I fought him. I busted him.
You fucked him up, right?
He
don't move his head that well and shit.
Fucked him up.
I did a good job of chopping his body. I'm a big believer in hurting somebody in the body, and then I took his head off numerous times in that fight. You know, the referee ended up stopping in the third round. He had like three cuts, but two of them were in the same eye. It was very bad. So they stopped it. So he's always been upset about that. Like, no, because, you know, I dropped him in the fight literally three times. He dropped me none. He didn't take me down. And he's always been like, I want a rematch. And I was told, I'll give you the rematch. I don't mind getting a paycheck. But now that we're both boxing, maybe I'll give it to him in boxing.
Yeah, that's going to be fun.
Yeah, straight boxing.
You'll get more money, too.
But these guys, though, they got to like the Nate guys and Jake and stuff. Man, boxing's a fucking tough place to make your money and craft.
You gotta. Only reason boxing was for you couldn't do nothing else. You had to go boxing. The poorest man sport. Wow, that's a poor man sport. They become rich.
But these guys here, they gotta give the fans what we're looking for, man. Like as a fan, I'm like, you know, I don't want to hate in the fight, but I'm like, did you see it, Mike?
Oh yeah, I saw it.
I don't know. What did you think? Like action wise, like,
you know,
man.
Nate dulled the fight up a little bit, you know, because he was really awkward to fight.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm glad they went 10 rounds. 10 rounds don't hurt anybody. It helps your endurance. You get confidence. You can go 10 rounds and it's nothing.
Yeah, and then you can do boom 12.
Yeah.
Where you go, you want to shout out the undercards? Any other undercards we need to look out for?
The whole undercard is going to be stacked. Make sure you go to my YouTube page, Jorge Masvidal, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'll be streaming it live from all the platforms. Catch all the fights there, man. It's been a freaking honor, man.
And it's going to be blood, blood, blood.
The fuck you talking about, blood? He's got the kid. Look at him. He look like a robot, huh?
Yeah, rock 'em, sock 'em.
Remember that? Hey, everyone. This is another exciting episode of Hot Boxing. I'm Mike Tyson.
I'm Hooker.
And we're out of here. Like last year.